I think the Nobel Peace Prize really has given you a platform and a voice to the children, as you said, who we don't hear every day. How do you hope to see the gains or the whole publicity that surrounded this Nobel Peace Prize? What are the gains you hope to see? We know that in Parliament, in the session that begins next week, there's a very important bill pending, a bill which actually makes it illegal for child labor. How hopeful are you that that will be passed, that we'll see politicians across parties unite to make this top priority?
Sonia ji, you know better than anyone that I'm not the man of publicity. I am the representative of invisibility and the soundlessness of millions of children in India and in the world. So for me, publicity does not mean much. I don't invest on it, my mind and my resources. But what I'm trying to trigger here, to ignite the sense of responsibility towards children to make our India a great India, leader of the world. And I see all the potential in my country. I always say that India is the land of 100 problems, but it is the mother of 1 billion solutions. We are using the strength of Nobel Peace Prize, you can say, globally, but also in India. This child labor amendment law is pending in the parliament for quite some time. It's almost 2 years. And I have made an earnest appeal to all parliament members recently that being the first Desi Indian to get the Nobel Peace Prize, it is not just the moral responsibility comes on my shoulders, on my head. I say that this is the Nobel Prize for every Indian who believe in the betterment of my nation, my country, my children. So it's the moral responsibility of the parliament and the parliament members to pass this bill, this law, which prohibits all forms of child labor up to the age of 14 and all worst forms of child labor, hazardous forms of child labor up to the age of 18, ensure rehabilitation, economic and educational rehabilitation of all these children under the law so that the children become legally entitled for the proper rehabilitation. And India is not a poor country, let me tell you. We are not so poor. We may have many poor people, but that is an old saying that we are not poor. We can ensure education and rehabilitation to our children with little more effort, and that's possible. And I'm quite hopeful about it.
We hope it will happen, and you had a good meeting with Prime Minister Modi also after you won the award. Of course, you've never won an Indian government award. You've often been considered a headache by the Indian government because you kept raising this issue. You were like a thorn in the flesh that wouldn't go away. So now, hopefully this time, this will be your award if the law actually does get passed. And we in the media, of course, will also try to keep putting pressure for this. But the sense of cynicism that often comes up in the issue of child rights is raised. There are often more pressing problems. We have to deal with this first. This is the priority. Why don't we wait and deal with this later? We have the Right to Education Act. We have many acts for children. The cynicism comes from the fact that none of them are implemented. Are you cynical about it?
Not really. I'm not cynical about anything else. I'm very optimistic because I believe that the solution of every problem lies in the womb of the problem itself. We have to make a little more effort and we will find the solution of any problem, every problem. In my country and globally, we are the land of Mahatma Gandhi, Sonia ji. We are the land of Mahatma Gandhi. And Mahatma Gandhi once said a great thing about the people like me and many of us, that first they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight with you, and finally, you will win. So, in this case also, the enforcement is a major challenge. But I have great respect for judiciary of my country, great respect. We have got the best judgments landmark judgments in the world from Indian Supreme Court and high courts about child slavery, about bonded labor, about missing children. They have redefined, in fact, reinterpreted the constitutional guarantee which was not clearly in the law, clearly spelled out in the laws. So it has been there. But it is also the collective responsibility. I am focusing more on the collective responsibility of every citizen who loves India cannot spare to love children. You have to love children, and then you cannot post policemen and the labor inspectors in every nook and corner of the country. We have to have inspectors. We have to have our own monitors. So the social responsibility, the social audit, the social monitoring, the social accountability is equally important. Once we decide that we are not going to accept any exploitation of children around us, how many children we are talking about? The government of India says that something around 4.7 or 4.8 million children are in full-time jobs. Kareeb 47, 48 lakh hain. And I tell you too, you come from that background of business and media and politics or whatnot, and each one of you, I'm sure, represent large segment of Indian society. If this hall, you people decide now to put an end to the scourge of child labor and child slavery and child bonded labor and illiteracy in this country, it is achievable, it is possible. But first step has to be taken. When I took the first step so many years ago, giving up my career as an electrical engineer, 34, 35 years ago, my mother was crying. My family, my friends thought that I am a crazy guy, I'm mad. That time, say 35 years ago, the electrical engineer career was a very lucrative career. But I took the first step. Why should I wait? If I believe in something, I will. If you believe in protection of children, if you believe in love for children, if you believe in compassion for children, if you believe in the betterment of my country, of your country, then why wait? Why wait? I am with you, and you have to promise that you are with me too. We together will do. I cannot do alone, but you can do.
I agree. The commitment, I think, as I said, it's a wonderful opportunity for you to interact with this diverse audience. Also, Kailashi, you are actually now receiving the Nobel Peace Prize on the 10th of December, a proud moment, as I said, for every Indian, and you will be receiving it with Malala. What is interesting that, again, this comes at a time when India-Pakistan, we know there's a stalemate, really, on dialogue, the negotiations are at a standstill, yet you said you always feel hope, and the timing of this award for both you and Malala is also very interesting. What is the appeal, perhaps, that both you and Malala, or you would like to make to both governments as well, of countries which share so much, even on the issue of education for children?
Well, I can't read between the lines what the Nobel Peace Committee or Prize Committee must be thinking. But some people, or most people, might not be knowing that I have been active in Pakistan as well for Pakistani children for more than 25 years, even 10 or 12 years before Malala was born. I was visiting Pakistan. I was trying to build movement against child labor. I was trying to build movement for education and literacy of Pakistani children in Pakistan. And then Pakistani government, which was martial law, Ziaul Haq's government, I narrowly escaped, actually. The police, the military police came with their guns and barrels on my head, but somehow God saved me. The children of India, Pakistan, and the world saved me. That was 25 years ago. So I have been so good friend of Pakistani people for so many years. So for me, it will go on. It will, because for me, peace is not something which is partly negotiable, partly not diplomatic issue across the table. It is not something which is a matter of preaching in the temples and holy places and mosques. Peace is a fundamental human right of every child who is born anywhere on the earth. Peace is inevitable. Peace is divine. Peace is a culture which we have to live in and build so that all children are born and grow in an environment of peace, because, as I said before, that they are not responsible for violence. We are responsible. As politicians, as statesmen, as adult people, whosoever, why children should suffer? So in India and Pakistan, I am sure that eventually the people-to-people relationship, if we really prioritize the welfare of children, rights of children, education of children in both the countries, then nobody can stop us to create a strong partnership and relationship between these two countries, I'm sure.
I'd like to actually open the session up now. I'm sure many in the audience would have questions for you. So go ahead, the lady in the back, if you could just get a mic to her. Yes, go ahead, please. You could just introduce yourself and ask your question.
Congratulations, Dr. Satyarthi. This is Jyotika. I work in a similar space. And I'd like to ask you, you had mentioned in one of your interviews that about Bal Panchayat. I just wanted to understand how you think that will empower this movement.
I always had a dream to create a child-friendly world. And that will remain utopia or just imagination if we don't act with good strategies, with good approaches, with good measurements and indicators and policies and programs and practices and so on. So it's a combination of several things. So we started in several villages in India, and now there are several hundreds. What we call child-friendly village. Child-friendly village is a village where all children are withdrawn from exploitative labor. No child marriage is taking place. No child trafficking is taking place from that village, with the participation of village community and village panchayat. The second step is that all children are enrolled in school. Boys, girls, Hindus, Muslims, high caste, low caste, whatever. All children must be in schools. Then the children of the village form a children parliament, Bal Panchayat. So Bal Panchayat is an elected body of youth and children. And that is a way of inculcation of democracy, deepening the democracy from the bottom up. And then they elect their leaders. And that Bal Panchayat leader or group of Bal Panchayat leaders interact with the village panchayat. And village panchayat in India, in Panchayati Raj system, has tremendous power. India has many wonderful laws and wonderful provisions. Panchayati Raj system is one of them, which empowers the village community. So these two panchayats, the village panchayat, which is official body, and the children's panchayat, Bal Panchayat, which is the moral body, they merge. They respect each other. So the youth leadership is invited in decision making about the priorities fixing, about the budgetary allocations of the village panchayat based on the demands of children. For instance, we work in about 400 villages or so, whatever. I can't recall exactly. But in most of the villages, the girls dropped out at certain age because there was no separate toilet for girls. Many children left school because there were not enough teachers. There were no safe drinking water. And there was discrimination in drinking water itself for the high caste and low caste people. These were very simple things which had resulted in 30, 40, 50% dropout in primary schools or in middle school. And the Bal Panchayats, which represent the entire village community of children, they raise these issues, and eventually the panchayat has to act, because no power is stronger than the moral power. And the real moral power comes from the children themselves. No panchayat can ignore it. No politician in the village can ignore it. And it is happening. So the Bal Panchayat experiment is something which is one step towards the creation of child-friendly world.
We've got so many questions. The man there at the back, if we just get a mic there. Yes, go ahead, please.
Namaste, Kailash ji. Very inspiring speech. My name is Projal Maitra. a very inspiring speech, and I thought what touched me was the simplicity by which you delivered it from the heart. What I would like to know from you is, we as responsible Indian citizens, what is your message for us? You asked us to listen to the silence. But if we want to go more than listening to the silence, what can we do in our way that can help this cause? I think it's a very, very dear cause to all of us.
Yeah.
I will assist you in answering his question.
Very good, very good. Thank you.
Why don't we let Kailashi finish, then we can come back to you, sir. What?
Actually, you have partly answered your question, that once you listen and you are an awakened person and listening, then break your silence. Speak out. Wherever you see a child is abused, there are many mechanisms, right from the police control room to special numbers, the child helpline, to the organizations like Bachpan Bachao Andolan, my organization. There are many NGOs, very, very good NGOs. Sometimes I think that they are doing even better than me, better than my organization. They're wonderful people. So try to contact them. Now we are living in the world of this Google thing, the Google Baba. Hum sab cheez Google Baba se poochte hain. Even Sonia ji, when the Nobel Peace Prize declared, somebody called up, actually from your channel, I met him lately, and he called, Kailash ji, Nobel Prize. So I thought that Nobel Prize, Peace Prize might have been given to someone somewhere in the world, and this guy is asking for my comment, as usual. So I started Googling, Nobel Peace Prize 2014, but it did not appear by that time. So it's very easy to find many helplines and many things. And you can raise this issue. But I don't believe in a typical charity. I believe in much more innovative partnership, much more partnership with the children. Relationship with the children are more friendly relations rather than just helping them out. I don't believe that your hand is upper hand and the child's hand is lower hand and he is a beggar and you are a giver. This is not fair. Second. So that is possible. So do something, act through media, act through social media, make phone calls and raise your voice. You can also find some time on your weekends and go close to your locality. And there are children must be working somewhere. There are street children. There are slum dwellers. You spend some time, 1 hour, sit with the children, and you will feel that you are empowered within you if you make a child smile. Hamari yahan kehte hain na, ghar se masjid bahut dur hai, chalo yun kar lein. Ghar se masjid bahut dur hai, chalo yun kar lein. Ek rote hue bacche ko hansaya jaye.
Kailash, you said Google, and we have a question for you on Twitter from those watching the summit, asking, is the government's response to your efforts quick enough? You made the point about NGOs. The whole NGO issue has now become also one where there's a slight mistrust that what are these NGOs actually doing? Are they working with government? Are they working against government? Do you feel the government's response to your efforts is quick enough? S. Purkayas has tweeted asking you this.
I would say that no one's response has been quick enough. There has never been the sense of urgency towards our children who are most deprived children. No sense of urgency in us. Us means not only the civil society organizations or NGO, but also with the government, with the businesses, everywhere. I think we have to build a sense of urgency for our children, and that is very important. And these things come only when the society is awakened, society is active, society is loudly speaking for our children. And that's why the Nobel Peace Prize for India, the first time for India, is important to take up the responsibility that we are going to respond with a sense of urgency.
Shout out our response really in terms of action. Our last few questions, I could be out of time. Go ahead, sir, and then we'll have to end. Go ahead. We'll go first to the man behind who's been waiting. Yes.
Well, I am Anil Verma, gold medalist in labor laws and labor welfare. I have studied in depth about the menace of child serfdom and their slaveries. If we really wish to have solution to this menace, I will supplement your answers, that if we remember the dictum, saas bhi kabhi bahu thi, and none of us present here was ever born in the present form. We were also child at the beginning. So we can well visualize the dictum of labor childhood, and solution lies within us. Rather than looking to any NGO or any other college or university for that purpose, or any parliamentary legislation, the solution lies within us to realize that we were also once child, and
yes.
We have also suffered the same thing, and so the children are suffering.
Yes. A final question. Go ahead, sir. Yeah? Okay. And then, okay, the young boy there who's final question with him after you. Go ahead.
And you make us proud. My name is Anshul Pathak. I'm a former banker. I was working in America, and now I came back about 8 years back. I work in the social sector now in education. So I quite understand what you say. You know, our thinking is that human life, human capital, is the most is the prized asset of this planet, and any life lost or unproductive has unmeasurable costs, and they actually do happen in terms of social unrest and so on and so forth. I'm going to share with you a feeling and a question. Something that has bothered me all my life, I've lived most of my life in Delhi, is that when we travel through red lights on crossings, we see these children accompanied by their parents or other adults begging. And I have two young daughters, and I feel very guilty at times, and I kind of, it hurts me. There is nothing that I can do in an organized manner to help them. My question to you is, in your movement, is there something that we can do for these kids?
First of all, I would tell that most of these children who are banging on the streets are not self-entrepreneurs. They are not the one who are begging for themselves or begging for the family. This is all myth. The reality is that most of the children are victims of forced beggary. They are trafficked. First of all, they are stolen, what we call the missing children. 15 children, according to NCRB's latest report, Government of India's report, 15 children go missing every hour in India, and 40% of them are not never found. The children who are missing somewhere in Bihar or Jharkhand or Karnataka or Kerala, they must be begging on the streets of Delhi. And sometimes, very cleverly, these people send some adult people with them, posing that they are their parents. They are not parents. This is all organized crime which goes on. So that's about beggary. But you can definitely do something. You can, I said before that whenever you have some free time, you can connect with some organization or some group. You can form a small group of like-minded people who can talk on these issues. To begin with talk, begin with awareness. Awareness is the first step towards solving the problem, any problem in the world. So begin with the awareness. And then connect with others. And slowly, it will become a bigger movement. There are several other initiatives there, so if you can find any initiative to join, that would be great. I will tell you one thing bigger, actually, Sonia ji, before we wrap up. Mm-hmm. That child labor or exploitation of children is not an isolated problem. I always work and advocate that there is a triangular paradigm or triangular relationship between poverty, child labor, and illiteracy. They form a chicken and egg kind of relationship, cause and consequence relationship. You cannot say that poverty is responsible for child labor. Child labor is equally responsible for poverty. Child labor is responsible for illiteracy. Illiteracy, vice versa, responsible for poverty and child labor both. So it becomes a vicious circle. We have to break that vicious circle by fighting child labor, by fighting poverty, and by fighting illiteracy. And I would suggest, I can think of something which we call the 6E formula in a broader context to fight all these things together. One is education. The first E is education, which all of us know. The second E is employability, which India needs, the whole world needs. Employability linked with education. The third E is entrepreneurship, because employability itself is not going to solve. It has its own limit. So entrepreneurship, the third E. The fourth E is equality. Because inequality is the mother of tensions and violence. And equality is solution for peace and stability. So equality. And then efficiency. We have to build efficiency in every sphere of life. We cannot live without quality. Efficiency comes out of quality. So quality and efficiency are two sides of the same coin. And the sixth thing, which is most important to connect with, to have a sustainable society, sustainable governance, sustainable economy, sustainable business, sustainable economy, ecology, that is ethic. We have to be ethical. Moral is most important. So education, employability, entrepreneurship, equality, efficiency, and ethics.
Kailash, the final question then we are completely out of time, but maybe you can meet him out right after this because he's a young boy.
I'm here for a few more minutes.
Chat, but thank you very much.
Thank you.